Yeah, you know, it's I like to paddleboard, as you know. I think I've taken you out to show you one of my passions. And the best analogy that I use is that people forget that it's a paddling sport. So people will typically, when they first paddleboard, they'll try to stand up, catch their balance, and then paddle. And what happens is they fall off, right? Because when the
You're
board
talking about me.
I didn't want to
He
say
took
it.
me out
I
there,
wasn't gonna call you
and I
out.
can wakeboard. I'm okay at certain types of things, but it took me a second.
Yes, but you learned. But you what you learned was, okay, I can't stand still on this board, and that while you're paddling, you don't have to focus on balancing. It's not a balance sport, right? It's a paddling sport. And so that's the same kind of thing that you're encouraging, is that you got to keep paddling, right? Even if you're moving slow, but you're moving forward, you won't fall off the board. But when you stop, you get scared, you get unbalanced, and it's easy to look around you and lose focus. And so whatever you do, keep paddling.
So I think I would say that if you're an entrepreneur and you're trying to really build something, the first thing is you really have to believe in it yourself. If you're a true believer in what you're doing and you know that your new mousetrap, your new concept has legs, you have to first believe it and then you have to sell it. I mean, my role has always sort of been monetizing things. And so I think you have to find a way to monetize things as opposed to just we're gonna do it and somehow it's gonna be bought. Someone's gonna come and we'll raise money until eventually it's worth a ton and then someone will buy us out. Well, they may never buy you out. You may raise money till the end of time and you may never have an audience that wants what you have. And so I think it's really good to figure out who your customer is, find a way to really support that customer and build something for them, and then be selling that in an ongoing, everyday kind of way.
Yeah, with the holidays coming up, Thanksgiving upon us. It really is a time to feel some gratitude, maybe more than most days. And today I am very thankful to really almost going back to a throwback type of concept. We're going to have two guests on today's show. First, I'm going to have Rick Spencer, co-founder with the Growth Factory, and we're going to talk a little bit about what's happening in this world of innovation. And then later in the show, we are going to have Rick Brown. He is with Marketstorm AI. It's an innovative marketing concept that is emerging right here in the hometown we love. But gratitude is one of those. It feels like that word is a little bit. I don't know if it's overused. I don't think it's over. I don't think we overappreciate people, but sometimes it gets used in a way that it almost seems flip it when people speak about it. But in reality, I am truly thankful for things in my life today. Life is pretty good, and I am thankful. What started off as a blank canvas, really after selling my companies about 10 years ago, and then deciding to start the podcast and really diving into investments a little bit as an angel investor and as a guy that invests into venture capital and other small business, as a podcaster and radio show host, as somebody who's just basically went out there and took the canvas and started throwing all kinds of things at it, having fun. But it wasn't until Rick Spencer came into my life that I really honed in on what this canvas could ultimately look like. Rick started with me a couple years ago, and he really is the inspiration behind this growth factory. And so, Rick, I want to say thank you for what you have brought to me personally in organizing and basically cleaning up my canvas a little bit, and really, putting us on a path, Monique and myself and our team, on a path to do something really, really game changing for this hometown that I love. So thank you. Let me start with that. But let me back up a little bit. Let's let you reintroduce yourself to our audience and to Sacramento.
Well, thank you, Mark. And I'm incredibly thankful for you as well. But yeah, so my name is Rick Spencer, and I'm one of the co-founders of the Growth Factory, and really focused on our fund that we've created, right? So the Growth Factory is both a venture fund and an accelerator. And so Monique's amazing at the community development and the programming. And so obviously her being managing director of the accelerator is the perfect fit. And we are so blessed to have her in that role. And then I needed to step up and learn a whole new, you know, practice and industry of venture capital, right? And luckily we have amazing partners like Moneta Ventures and Dale Carlson and, you know, Barry Broom, who's going to be on the show as well later on today. So, you know, it's been an exciting ride. And as a former entrepreneur, learning the other side of the table, if you will, has really inspired me to help more entrepreneurs, right? So I grew a company organically and sold that in 2017. So I saw early success. And then I wanted to learn the venture world. And I saw the grind and the challenge of these entrepreneurs and the constant rejection, the challenges, the fear, the uncertainty, the doubt. And so being able to now be a venture capitalist, it's hard for me to say that. It doesn't feel like the coat doesn't fit just yet, but I'm excited about the future that we're building. And, you know, I'm incredibly, incredibly grateful for you, Mark, because, you know, you're thankful for me, but I wouldn't be here today working on such an amazing opportunity without you. And I know we often debate this idea of celebrating small wins, but I think today is a perfect day to celebrate when you think about the foundation that you laid. I mean, starting with just telling stories about entrepreneurs and celebrating entrepreneurs, that already ignited this revolution that you talk about because it brought the community together. It made people hope, it made people believe, and it brought people in this region together in a new way of thinking about innovation and thinking about startups and venture capital and how it has economic development. And then you said, look, imagine a town where all the business leaders unite. And if you think about today, just today, we just came from the SAC Business Journal's Innovation Award, and two of our cohort companies, Growth Factory, won. So we've got some great progress there. But all the business leaders that were in there recognized you as a leader that was helping bring entrepreneurs together, business leaders together, government groups together, media partners together. And so by you having that vision and putting it out there, because it's a risk, right? People may think you're crazy, they don't understand it. And so you put it out there and it became reality. And now, you know, we're taking it to the next level. And, you know, I couldn't be more thrilled, but I want to celebrate you, Mark, because I'm thankful for the courage you showed, for the vision that you had, because it all started with you.
Thank you, Rick. I appreciate that. And so let's talk about what we actually are doing, and because it's rewarding for me to be investing into these startups. But we've launched the Growth Factory, and we just invested into our first 15 companies, rockstar entrepreneurs with world-class potential. And as you mentioned today, excuse me, at the Innovation Awards, we had a couple of our companies win. But we also had some of the Haney Biz portfolio was recognized in the event as well. So I want to ask you, so how did you feel? So in the Innovation Awards, sponsored by the Business Journal, they break them up in different categories, advanced manufacturing, and in the software, I think it was the software and hardware category, we had Anthony Romano of Cretelligence, a real estate software company that the Haney Biz group is invested into. I'm invested into it personally, let's just call it that. And then we had Andrew Gardner with Humanly. He has a software company that helps people with their hiring practices. They were competing against each other for the big W. And I was like, who do I root for? What was going through your head?
So I was sitting next to Anthony and team, and I had, through the Angel Portfolio, worked with their team about a year and a half ago when they were just starting to expand. They were just starting to catch that first traction. They, you know, had acquired some talent on the East Coast, and they were figuring out that plan. And so I had the pleasure of being there with their management team in one of those kind of infancy meetings. And so I couldn't be more thrilled for him and his team to see the traction that they've had. And again, it benefits Sacramento, right? They're hiring. And then obviously Humanly, we've been following them, and Andrew Gardner and team are just tremendous. But here's the thing, Mark, is that you don't want to pick your favorites, right, when you're celebrating and supporting so many folks. But I was sitting next to both Anthony and his HR director, Toby Lutz. And what was I talking about? Humanly. And saying, have you heard about Humanly? You should be testing Humanly. You should be testing Spark, another one of our HR companies. And so here you have, as you keep, you know, laying it down, success breeds success. And so Anthony's team is hiring and growing. And what is he looking to do? He's looking to be a mentor. He's now helping us test this next generation. And we see the same thing with Skyslope and Trifecta. I mean, that has been extremely exciting to see. Certainly the business leaders that have supported us that have been investing in this region for a while, but the capital that we're bringing on the sidelines, the talent that we're bringing on the sidelines, and the community that we're building, it wasn't about competition. It was about collaboration. And with that collaboration, we're all winning.
Yeah, you used one of my lines, which is, you know, an age-old line, success breeds success. But I've been using that more because I've begun to see it. I've begun to believe in it more. And you mentioned Anthony Romano, who is Cretelligent. He came from a company called CoreLogix, which had tremendous success and ended up having a nice exit. And so Anthony and his team are, there are several CoreLogix people on that team, right? So the success, the offspring of that success story created the spark that is driving Cretelligent and Andrew coming out of Skyslope, and one of his early teammates is also out of Skyslope. So yeah, it's interesting to see that happen, and I think it's making all of us believe just a little bit more.
Yeah, well, and the celebration doesn't stop there. I mean, if I think about the rest of the day, like I said, we have Barry Broom coming in from GSEC. And GSEC has been incredibly supportive, and Barry Broom specifically, you know, putting the growth factory on their agenda, right? It would be easy for him to say, hey, we need to focus on MLS. We need to focus on Aggie Square. We need to focus on, you know, attracting these large corporates and everything they have going on. It would be easy to say, you know, yeah, we're supporting the growth factory, but not really give us the time of day. But he has embraced us. He has put us in front of the members of GSEC. And so now we're having conversations with SMUD. You know, Five Star Bank obviously is hugely supportive, but, you know, with Accenture, with Western Health Advantage, these leaders are stepping up and saying, we believe in this and how can we help? So that's incredibly exciting. And then let's go on to this evening. We've got another entrepreneur, Brandon Robinson, Flatstick Pub. I mean, if you have been in the restaurant world at all over the last 2 years, what a challenge, right? And so he's had every challenge presented to him, just launched a new restaurant in South Lake Tahoe. Soon as it opened, wildfires. I mean, he has seen it all. And amidst all of those challenges, he said, I want to see this be successful. You invested to him. Now he wants to pay it forward. And he's having an event for us at his venue in downtown Sacramento. So, you know, there's plenty of reason to celebrate and plenty of great things that are happening, and we're just getting started.
Yeah, you know, I want to make sure, I hadn't thought about bringing up Brandon Robinson and Flatstick Pub, but they're right in the heart of DoCo, which is basically a place that became a ghost town during most of the pandemic. So while a number of restaurants did okay, had a brief, very painful window of moments, these guys went in almost the entire pandemic before they could even reopen because of where they were located and their inability to, you know, basically move it outside. They had to stay inside, yet they didn't quit. They didn't quit. And I think anybody listening to the show or thinking about their life, this Thanksgiving Day weekend, it's like we go through tough times. Somebody may be going through something very, very difficult right now. But you know what? If you don't quit, you will get through it. And then at some point, you're going to be filled with this gratitude for the people that you put in your life that helped you to get over the hump. I think that's where Brandon Robinson is today. I know that that's where I am. And so it's really cool to see it come together. And it really is. There's a lesson in there that if you just don't quit, despite how bad it looks, you know, anything is possible if you put the right people in your life. So great point, and it's a great day. Today's a day to celebrate, and it's a remarkable moment. I think it's a turning point for Sacramento. When you came on board right before COVID hit, right before we even knew what COVID was, in December. And then all of a sudden we had to regroup. We were doing events. We were knocked on our heels, and you reformulated our approach with the help of Monique and I, and it became the Growth Factory, and then now it's manifested itself into really an emerging brand in venture capital in the region, and we're getting known as venture capitalists, as you said, and it's there really aren't that many in Sacramento. There's Moneta and there's Impact and there's a few others, but there really aren't that many when right down the street in the Bay Area, there's so much venture capital money, just not enough investable companies.
Yeah, and we're, like you said, we're already seeing these venture firms outside of the region showing interest and wanting, you know, to follow us. And they really see, because, you know, they've built funds that really need to invest later, you know, Series A and beyond. And so they really can't write checks small enough to bet on these early stage companies, right? And so they're looking for deal flow. They're looking to be connected. But seeing what we're doing with, you know, our platform acceleration program, you know, they're really excited about how we're de-risking this and how we're leveraging this emerging opportunity in Sacramento where the timing is right. You know, like you said, you mentioned COVID, and David Lichtman at the Business Journal this morning at the Innovation Awards brought up a good analogy of, you know, the wildfires in the with the sequoia trees and how they surrounded those trees to protect them with aluminum foil. But actually, that fire breeds new trees, right? Those seeds do not germinate without that fire, without that crisis. And so, you know, you've talked about the blessings that COVID delivered, right? That crisis allowed us to clear our minds and galvanize people and germinate like we've never done before in this region. And, you know, now people are taking notice, not only inside the region and how they can help, but I think Sacramento is stepping up as far as a region for the future.
Well, let's talk about timing for the founders. Obviously, we are in, we're a 10-year overnight success, if you will, because what we're doing right now is really working. And maybe that's too strong of a term to say we're over a success yet, but we've got off to a great start with the Growth Factory, and the Haney Biz portfolio of companies has done really, really well. So in some ways, we've been pretty successful despite not having you know, the Growth Factory in mind when we initially launched. But now, as we put our startup hat on, as we get in the trenches with these 15 companies to help them accelerate, how important is timing to them? Because some of these companies are very early stage, and they, you know, they've got to win because they only have a small runway of time.
Yeah. So interesting. You know, I've been studying as much as I can in the venture world to understand, you know, what is this recipe for success? And just reading some research the other day about the number one predictor when you look at a large data set of startup companies that have been venture backed, the number one predictor is market timing. And you see really clear examples. Airbnb is a great example. You know, when they got turned down by several venture firms that didn't understand the solution, that really people are going to rent their homes, they're going to open up their homes for money. And so they got plenty of rejection. Well, what changed? The recession. The recession of 2008 hit, and people said, yeah, I need a little more income. So the market timing was perfect for them to validate their business model and now become a world leader. And, you know, all those venture folks that said no are, you know, really disappointed, right? And then look at COVID. Look at Zoom, right? Most people don't know the story of Zoom, that the founder of Zoom actually came from Cisco, who bought WebEx, right? So before Zoom, WebEx was the most, you know, prolifically used web conferencing software. I used to do a lot of contract work with Cisco, and, you know, they were constantly moving that forward. Well, this individual that founded Zoom, he was part of WebEx, and he kept telling his leadership, we need easier access, better features. And after getting told no too many times, he said, nope, I'm out, and I'm going to go do this. I'm going to make this happen. And then look at the timing, right? He had been, you know, selling to small businesses and individuals, but it was the most easy to use platform, and the timing changed. And now Zoom is a verb, right? Mm-hmm. It's like Kleenex, you know, people, you know, and so imagine if Cisco had been positioned, you know, with the same insights, which they were, but they didn't take advantage of it, right? So market timing is the biggest predictor of success with these startups. And that's where the Growth Factory is different, is because we're really focusing on that market acceleration piece in the beginning so that we can see, is the timing right in the market? Do we see the traction that validates that the timing is right, right? Right. We can bet on the founder. We can know that those founders are likely going to win at something. We can say, you know, the solution makes sense and customers are validating that. But the timing piece, you don't know until you press. And so with the Growth Factory, we're creating the platform to help press in that space and validate, is the market timing correct?
Interesting that you say that. Jeff Bezos, in a recent thing that I read or listened to, I don't remember, and so I'm sort of paraphrasing, he says, I get asked a lot about what will change in the next 30 years. So how will the world be different 30 years from now? And he says, the one question I do not get, which I wish I got, is what will not change in the world over the next 30 years? And some of the companies that we're invested into, I would say all the companies that we are invested to in the Growth Factory are focused on in areas where it will not change over the next 30 years. We know that one of the companies is a cybersecurity company. We know that cybersecurity is an emerging issue in society today, but we also know that the world is going more and more digital, and this is a problem that will not be gone in the years to come. And one of the companies that we are invested into is working with parents to connect with their children through a function, little activities. And you know what? We know that in 30 years from now, parents are going to still care about the childhood development of their offspring, right? It's going to be a big deal. That is not going away.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, cybersecurity couldn't be a better example. It's not only not going away, but it's going to be, you know, most people predict that we won't fight wars with tanks and guns. We will fight wars online. And so if you imagine the paradigm shift that describes, cybersecurity is not just an emerging industry. It's going to be critical to our security, to our future, and how we live as human beings, right?
Yes.
And, you know, being, you know, making memories box, you mentioned, you know, how many distractions are there now for kids and parents? It's easy. You know, you can go to a restaurant, it's a great example, and see a family of four sitting there. They've been busy with all their activities all week, and here's the one time for them to come to the dinner table and connect, and they're all staring at their phones. And so never before, and that degrades, you know, the family relationship, it degrades our society. And so that's only going to get worse. And so we have to find those solutions to really help humanity.
Yeah. I mean, if my parents taught me anything, it's do not quit. And I think referencing back to what I've been working on for the last several years, where I've been a radio show guy, podcaster, part-time investor into these startups and real estate and other things. The one thing that I didn't do is quit. And I think so. The market timing for venture capital is upon us, right? It is a good time to get in to this space. It is a good time to start doing angel investing. It is. I mean, this asset class is absolutely blowing up. So, I guess the message out there is like Brandon Robinson, like us. We just didn't quit. The timing will sort of sneak up on you when you don't expect it.
Yeah, you know, it's I like to paddleboard, as you know. I think I've taken you out to show you one of my passions. And the best analogy that I use is that people forget that it's a paddling sport. So people will typically, when they first paddleboard, they'll try to stand up, catch their balance, and then paddle. And what happens is they fall off, right? Because when the board...
You're talking about me.
I didn't want to say
it. You took me out there.
I wasn't going to call you out.
I can wakeboard. I'm okay at certain types of things, but it took me a second.
Yes, but you learned. But what you learned was, okay, I can't stand still on this board, and that while you're paddling, you don't have to focus on balancing. It's not a balance sport, right? It's a paddling sport.
Yeah.
And so that's the same kind of thing that you're encouraging, is that you got to keep paddling, right? Even if you're moving slow, but you're moving forward, you won't fall off the board. But when you stop, you get scared, you get unbalanced, and it's easy to look around you and lose focus. And so whatever you do, keep paddling.
Whatever you do, keep paddling. And you know, that you talked about being afraid. So many of our startups have fears and uncertainties and doubts and stress. like maybe I had on the paddleboard when I first got out there. But courage is contagious, right? Mm-hmm. As I saw you with confidence and other people out on Lake Natomas that had plenty of confidence, I began to want to try it. Normally, I might have quit. If I didn't know how to do it, maybe I would have quit. But you get in and around other people that have courage, and it is contagious in a way. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing that within the growth factory. I don't know if you've seen that within our group of cohorts, or you know, our cohort, our group of founders.
Yeah, they're stepping up as a community and encouraging each other and being vulnerable and sharing their fears and uncertainties and doubts. But you know, in a way that is helping all of them with one, feeling connected and not alone. And that's, you know, critical, right? Like nobody builds a truly great company alone, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so helping them not feel alone, but also just learning from others as others make mistakes and others have success. And all of that is part of the journey, right? And if they can accelerate their learning with less mistakes, with more people involved, that's where we'll see success. And so that's already happening. And it's happening mainly organically, right? I mean, we had to lay the foundation to bring all these people together and to bring the investors together and to bring the partners together. So, you know, it's not discounting all of the work that we've done to take the lead and make this happen. But, you know, the human connection, even amidst all those challenges, is really magical. And the more that we can create the environment for that, you talked about venture capital and, you know, yes, everyone wants to win with their investments, but we also know that if we invest into 100 companies and 100 founders over 4 years, and we can help all 100 of those founders succeed, even if that is our objective and that is our success criteria, the byproducts of that will be a return. The byproducts will be more jobs. The byproduct will be better communities, right? And so that's what I'm you know, most thankful for, Mark, is your courage to create the environment to allow us to build what we're doing right now so that we can have more successful founders and a better region.
I appreciate that. And, you know, we have a few minutes left, and I just want to maybe take a glimpse into the coming year as we approach the end of 2021. Many people are beginning to do their strategic planning for 2022. Gosh, it's already here. We are, in fact, we have a couple of planning sessions coming up early next month. What kinds of things are on your mind as you look at the what we need to do in 2022 to take this, what we've started, to continue to do a little paddling with some success in 2022?
Yeah, so I think you know, we're at a great start as far as investor involvement, and we talk about the backyard advantage, and our investors are very engaged, which is amazing. And the mentor side, you know, we're looking for expert mentors. We're seeing great progress there. You know, we definitely want to extract from this region more technical talent, right? Everyone's talked about this migration of talent from the Bay Area. And so, you know, where are these people, right? Everyone's met them, you know, kind of occasionally, but it's, you know, it seemed like they're like unicorns hiding, right?
And so, yeah, where are these Google and Facebook workers?
Yeah, we need to
that
find
moved here.
Yeah, so if those are your neighbors, if those are your new friends, we want to meet them because that's you know, a new opportunity that's emerging, you know, in this space. And then, you know, in the corporate space, and we say corporate, I think most people think like blue chip, major Fortune 500 companies, but if you're an employer with 25 employees, with 100 employees, and you believe that, you know, if this region succeeds, you will succeed and your family will succeed and your community will succeed, we need to know more of those people, right? Because, again, we talked about timing. If we can really press and understand if that timing's correct, and not only for the success of our fund and our accelerator, but for these founders, if they can quickly identify that the timing's not right and they need to pivot, or they need to find, you know, another solution for their problem, they're in love with that problem, that's going to, again, make that founder successful. And that founder succeeding, you know, is just a gift to this region that multiplies and multiplies. And so, you know, those are the critical opportunities we have going forward. Is we can always use more investors, we can always use more mentors, and we can always use more business leaders that know that, you know, what we're doing is something that they want to be involved and part of.
Yeah, it's interesting to think about why people get involved. People are rallying. We're calling it the Backyard Advantage, which really is the Backyard Dream Team. And the people that are coming into the Growth Factory as mentors and investors, they are nothing short of world class. We have people who have built incredible companies, had great exits, are coming on and saying, how do I mentor? I want to help the next one in line. And this, there's sort of a club effect that is building where you take the best of the best of Sacramento and you put them into on a project, and great things happen. We've begun to see that. So if you want to be part of that club effect, I would wholeheartedly agree with Rick, is come on, come see us, and let's see if you may be able to fit in. The other thing, though, that I get out of this, besides a financial return and hanging around, people who've had this tremendous success, being around very ambitious people with extremely innovative ideas, this is an interesting combination. And when you, especially at my age, when you get to live vicariously through these people that are really in the process of solving the world's biggest problems, really in the process of changing the world, there's nothing like it. Even if you are playing a very small role in that success story, there's nothing like it.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you talk a lot about health and your pursuits of health. And so the mental challenge that you get to participate with when people are solving these world-changing problems, just even like you said, if you're just, participating in a small degree with that, that mental challenge helps you personally. It helps you with your relationships. It helps you with your communities. And so it's always been something that's super exciting to me, is that, there's these massive problems that are facing us today and facing us in the future, and these amazing people that have the courage to solve these problems. And if we continue to succeed and they succeed, it's going to be amazing for our future.
Yeah. Make a plan, work the plan. That is what we're going to do this coming year. We'll be around building the Backyard Dream Team, improving the Backyard Advantage for the hometown here in Sacramento and in the greater Sacramento region. That's going to be the plan. If you want to be a part of our plan, if you want to be a part of this effort, if you have a love of entrepreneurship and a belief in the power of entrepreneurship, and you are somebody who really has roots down in our community, or is thinking that they might want to put down roots right here in our community, then you need to hit us up. You need to hit up Rick, Monique, myself, and let's figure out a way that we can partner together. So with that said, one final thank you to the Dream Team that may be listening, the cohort, the investees, the founders, the ones that put it all out on the line. And, of course, my team here at Haney Biz, which includes Scott over there, who's running AV for us and does so much more, Tammy, my son Marcus, for what he does and what he's done for so many people. And, of course, Rick and Monique Brown, and for you today, Rick, for really figuring out a way to help us come together with a real plan that is working.
Thank you, Mark.
Today we have the pleasure of talking about a few of my favorite subjects. First of all, entrepreneurship and winning. But as well, we're going to be talking about marketing and how to grow your business, and how to use a technology platform to really have some success in scaling and in growing. So today I am joined by Rick Brown. He is the founding partner, chief marketing officer at Marketstorm AI. How you doing, Rick?
I'm doing great. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Thank you for coming on the show.
Yeah, my
pleasure. We have a mutual friend, Craig Freeman, who's been on the show a number of times, built some successful businesses. And now he's a part of Marketstorm, am I right?
That's right, yeah. Actually, we named Craig our CEO a few months ago.
Okay.
And it's been phenomenal.
How's he working out?
He's doing just fine. He's doing just fine.
For those of you who don't know, Craig has built OC Communications, one of the largest companies in the region, and is an employee-owned company and had a tremendous amount of success. So now he's joined your company, and you made him the CEO.
That's right.
What went into that decision?
Well, so funny enough, he's been a part of it since day one. We actually formed the company together with myself, Craig Freeman, and our other partner, Carol Lawson. But we were having this discussion. We were filling out some paperwork a few months ago, and he said, you know, we don't really have a CEO. And Carol and I looked at each other and said, yes, we do, Craig. You're the CEO. Oh,
right.
So, I mean, that decision was really based on, I mean, you look at his background, right? Who mm-hmm. else in the region has scaled a company that started in his closet with his wife to, you know, nine figures and all, you know, just crazy success. So so we're very fortunate to have him involved.
That's great. But you were the... you were the inspiration behind the company. It started with you and what
Carol.
Happened? How did you guys get started?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So I would actually say that I was not the inspiration behind the company. So I was in another venture. I have a company called Catchlight. I was working with the Farm to Fork Festival and Mike Testa, who I'm sure you know, and Business Sacramento, amazing people. And we got a call in from this lady who was running a little nonprofit for wineries. And they said, hey, can we meet? We want to be a part of the Farm to Fork Festival. And so I took this meeting, and I kind of believe in always taking the meeting. But in all honesty, and Carol knows this, I was thinking this meeting was probably going to go nowhere. Just a small nonprofit, which is great, but I'll give her some helpful tips and move on. So I had a short window, and I said, let's grab a coffee. And so as soon as I sat down with her, my mind started blowing. I was like, who is this lady and how have I not met her before? So she, her background, she started telling me was, she actually, worked, for Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger as the head of all things for CA.gov. So she had something like 4,000 IT people working for her.
Wow.
She took all the website systems from 47th to number one, across all the rankings, you know, Brown rankings, et cetera. And she told me how she had then, after that, become a second-level sommelier, which is incredibly hard feat.
Is that?
So basically, it means you're one of the most. Yeah, you're messing with me. But she's just incredibly talented. And then she went back to Harvard to get her master's in data science, working with the best data scientists in the world on IBM's Watson. And so she started talking to me about how she uses AI just for her little wine organization. And as she started talking to me, I said, you have a business. You don't even know it yet. And so that was sort of the beginning of Marketstorm.
Okay. And then what happened from there? Because I want to take us through that journey that founders go through. A lot of times it's not easy. I would say virtually 100% of the time it is a battle at the beginning. But how did it go with you guys?
Yeah, well, I would totally agree with that. And, you know, I have to go on a lot of panels and stuff. And I usually am talking people out of starting businesses because I know how hard it can be. This company was a little different because we really started with this amazing technology, but we didn't know exactly where it was going to go. So we started, I'll give you one story. We went out to this little wine community, and the initial idea was actually that we were going to help all these small wineries and sort of bundle them as like a co-op advertiser. And we would use AI for that. And so we went out and met all these wineries, and we probably sampled a little bit. And by the end of the day, I quickly realized there's not enough budget in, you know, 10, 20, 30 small wineries to really create a full business out of this. And there's so many more uses for this technology that we could utilize for larger companies that, you know, aren't Nike, they're not, you know, Lululemon, but they're companies with enough backing to really grow. And so we had to pivot quite a bit because the early stages, I think we were kind of thinking of it for things that we liked as opposed to things that we really could grow.
Okay. So what's the business today? Describe how the product and how the business works.
Yeah. So today what we do, we work with companies all over the country. Typically, it's sort of mid-sized businesses, maybe 10 to 50 million is kind of where their revenues would sit. And we find out who they're really looking for. So you know, my whole background in media, sports, everything I've done, it's always been kind of about association. So it's like, oh, you have a Mercedes dealership. Well, you want to take them to high-end events or VIP rooms at stadiums and things like that and connect them with the right audience. But it's always been sort of close or aligned as opposed to direct. What we do is actually we work with a bunch of different companies. So a lot of our companies are sitting like home services, you know, HVAC suppliers, things like that. And they're looking for someone to come in and buy a $20,000, $15,000 replacement for a major part of their home service. So we work with clients like that all over the country, and we find their exact customers in real time, and serve them ads in real time and bring them into the fold.
Okay, so you serve them ads on digital media? Is that how that works?
Well, all sorts of media, but all ran through the digital space. So think of anything that's connected to the internet. That's sort of our platform where we acquire information and where we send out ads.
Okay, now how does it work? How do you walk me through, you know, like a win story, if you will?
Yeah, so absolutely. So we had, you mentioned referrals before. We had a customer that had heard about our work. They were a smaller company, actually one of our smaller clients up in the Washington area. And they said, you know, we're one of, you know, four or five major HVAC suppliers in this town, HVAC providers. But we really want to grow. And we heard you have this crazy technology where you can go find the right leads for us and drive them home. And so we got a report literally 2 weeks ago about their transition from this past year. So they've been working with us since January 1st. And the report was from January 1st to October 18th of this year. And they did a side-by-side analysis of that year versus the year prior. So the year prior in that time period, they had actually more leads than we provided them. But they only had a 44% closing ratio on those leads. And of those leads, they were only driving about $2.5 million in revenue. The following year, working primarily with us, they actually had less leads, but a higher, you know, doubled the closing ratio to 88%, which means we're bringing them better leads. And they actually had over $6 million in revenue in that same time period.
Okay.
And so they attribute a lot of that to the work that we do in finding the right targets for them and driving them home.
Well, I just want to sort of walk through this. Okay, so I'm an sure. HVAC supplier. Yep. I'm a supplier. Who's my customer? Is it a installer or is
no,
it a
so
is an end user?
End user, yeah. So you're trying user. To find the people in those neighborhoods who are like, I don't know.
It's a residential homeowner.
Exactly.
Okay, so a residential homeowner that what? How do you narrow? You said you narrow it down, right?
Yep.
So they're more qualified leads.
Yep.
How do you narrow it down?
So we really start with behaviors. So when they're online, they start to think, really what's happening is people now think online.
Okay.
So they start to go, I don't know if my heater is going to make it through the winter. And the first thing that they do is they go to their phone or they go to their desktop or their laptop and they go, how do you know if your heater is not going to make it? It feels like cooler air is coming out of my heater as opposed to hot air, or it takes a while for it to get started. As soon as they do anything in that sort of behavior set, we're using natural
language
processing.
So like their search history.
Well, it's really live. So live real-time data. So we're capturing people in the moment.
Okay, so principles in terms, you've got multiple businesses happening,
That's
it sounds
right,
like.
Yeah.
So somebody might say, hey, why not focus on one? How are you deciding how to allocate your time and why not focus on one?
Right. That's a great question. And not the first time I've gotten it, of course. I guess I've always kind of been a little bit entrepreneurial, and I find that if I was to just focus on one, I may not have caught this opportunity, right?
Okay.
And so so I just want to make sure that anything I'm doing, that there's success coming out of it and that it's actually growing. And anytime where I feel like I'm not bringing value, I say, hey, I'm going to bow out of this thing. And I just had a great venture, and I won't go into details, but a biotech venture that has phenomenal upside. But it'd be too much of a lift, and I have too much going on with other stuff, so I kind of pull away.
Okay, so let's think about our audience here.
Sure.
Early stage entrepreneurs trying to figure out, what they want to do. Any words of wisdom or advice, principles that you sort of live by in order to achieve the success?
Yeah, I mean, and there's people that have done much better than I have, and so I don't know all things. But a couple things that I think about a lot is I always, when I'm speaking at different engagements, I sort of want you to really decide that you really want to do it. So if you're thinking about starting a company and you don't have to, then don't do it. If you don't feel the need to start that company or that venture, then you should probably walk away from it. But if you really, really are dedicated, you really want to go all in, then you got to go all in. You got to, sort of burn the ships, right, as they say.
Mm-hmm.
And then you talk a lot about partnerships and who to go into business with. And I think that it's a really critical thing to choose partners well. And what I find is that people go, oh, I have this great idea. A couple of my buddies had the same idea. We all think it's great. We're going to go make millions and millions of dollars. Everything's going to work out perfectly. And that's sort of the whole game plan when they get started. And that to me is really scary. And I think people are going to lose everything when they do that sort of thing. I think it's sort of good to slow down, take your time, build out the concept, and then jump when you're really ready to jump all in.
Go all in. Anything you would have done differently in building the business?
Yeah, you know the old adage to hire slowly and fire quickly?
Yes.
I think that that's a good idea, especially when you're thinking about ventures. If something is not, if you feel something in your gut is not for you, it's not for you.
Don't fire slowly and fire quickly.
Yeah. So even, you know, more so than employees do that with ventures. I would say in terms of things I would do differently. Yeah, I think choosing the right business partners from the start. I'm very fortunate. I have amazing business partners. We mentioned Craig before, phenomenal, you know, resource, wonderful guy, Carol Lawson, you know, it's the type of person that will send you an email at 4 a.m. just because she's thinking about something and then apologize to you later in the day for sending you something so early. So just, I mean, great people, right? And then yeah. In my, you know, my music venture, you know, I have great partners like the Stereotypes, you know, who are Bruno Mars partners, you know? Mm-hmm. So if they're good enough for Bruno Mars and Kanye West and Celine Dion, I think they're probably good enough for me. But I haven't always had, you know, partners that I think you're aligned with. And I think that that's a big thing. Where I think I've gone wrong is where I've had partners that maybe just our lifestyles were different, you know, where, a Friday night might look different in my house than some of the partners that I've had in the past. And I think that it's really good to sort of align with people that have a similar lifestyle to you, a similar culture understanding as you, because you're going to have to go through a lot of hard days together. And if you are living and thinking and feeling in super different ways, it might not be a long-term romance, let's say.
Yeah, it is like
partner.
A marriage, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it is like a marriage. Yeah. Okay, so one final question. Just closing thoughts to entrepreneurs, thinking about you know, where you're at in your journey and other people that might be a little bit early on. Just closing thoughts as we send this thing out to the airwaves.
So I think I would say that if you're an entrepreneur and you're trying to really build something, the first thing is you really have to believe in it yourself. If you're a true believer in what you're doing and you know that your new mousetrap, your new concept has the legs, you have to first believe it and then you have to sell it. I mean, my role has always sort of been monetizing things. And so I think you have to find a way to monetize things as opposed to just we're going to do it and it's going to be bought. Someone's going to come and we'll raise money until eventually it's worth a ton and then someone will buy us out. Well, they may never buy you out. You may raise money till the end of time and you may never have an audience that wants what you have. And so I think it's really good to figure out who your customer is, find a way to really support that customer and build something for them and then be selling that in an ongoing, everyday kind of way.
Yeah. Yeah. Very good. I want to thank you definitely for coming on the show. Rick Brown, is with Marketstorm AI. I want to make sure I get the name right. Thank you for coming on the show. I love your business. I love your business partners and really appreciate what you do being an entrepreneur right here in the Sacramento region.
Yeah, thank you so much. Appreciate it.
You bet. Thank you.
Thanks for watching today's show. My goal for every episode is that you find a takeaway, something tangible you can use in your business today. And if you have a comment about a favorite takeaway, feel free to put it in the box below. And if you have a topic that you'd like me to bring up on the show, don't forget to let me know. And also, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel if you want to learn more about entrepreneurship. Because at Haney Biz, we are always by your side.